Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today we have the producer news for you, and we're going to go through the top headlines in the music industry and how it applies to you. So let's get started. This article is from Wired.com. It's music can't last forever, not even on the internet. And the article goes through SoundCloud's history, and it goes through the history of records and how you can't, you know, masters of records used to be damaged or lost, or maybe a part of the studio flooded and it destroyed some of the masters in the old days, and that's all they had as a backup for the records, so they couldn't reissue music. But nowadays, with the internet, it feels like everything's eternal for the most part. But the issue here is that everybody's hosting their eternal music, quote-unquote eternal music, on the servers of a specific website. So, for example, if SoundCloud servers went down, everybody's music who was streaming on SoundCloud would go out, okay? So that means they would be vulnerable to the changes of SoundCloud. And the lesson we can take from this is don't rely on one medium, okay? Regardless of if your music's eternal or not, I'm sure there's going to be a copy of your music floating around somewhere, especially if it has, if you're a big artist and you have a lot of attention. A lot of fans like to copy your music. And put it, you know, copied and uploaded here and there, like Hulk Share and all the torrents, etc. But I'm not talking about the justice of torrents and the justice of, you know, uploading music without permission. That's not what I'm talking about today. The point here is that, you know, people are worried about their music vanishing based on the success of a company. So there are talks about SoundCloud and going out of business and losses and everything else. But again, that CEO response, even if we're looking at the stats of SoundCloud, it doesn't matter. What matters is, you know, which medium are you using to reach a specific audience, okay? You can utilize these platforms, SoundCloud, Spotify, Pandora. You can utilize those to reach more people, but think of it just as that, a reach. It's not your core business to be on these businesses unless they're really helping you out to build your audience. Then you want to focus more on these platforms. But I've seen it way too many times. Just like producers gave all their efforts into SoundClick, you know, you're building your business around a different business. So when that business has troubles or doesn't function the way you want it to function, you too will have those same issues, and that's holding you back from growing. And also, you have to ask, are these companies that you're working with helping you grow as a business? If they're not, move on and just treat it as something to gain reach, just like you would an advertisement. It's a reach element. It's not your main source of income. You know, on YouTube, if you're relying on YouTube AdSense, I understand that that's an easy way to get started. But building your business around YouTube is not the way to go. You know, YouTube, for example, if I advertise on YouTube, it costs me 1,000 times more than I get as a receiver of that ad money. So, for example, if I'm promoting an ad on some video, I'll pay, let's say, $100 to get that ad to run, okay, on YouTube. But the person, so YouTube gets their cut, but then the person who has the ad run on their material only gets about 1 cent per that $100. And I calculated it before. I don't have the statistics here. One day I'll go back and figure it out. But on YouTube, you get about $1 for every 1,000 plays. And when you're paying for advertisement, let's say, I have to look at the calculations, but 1,000 plays would probably cost you $100. Okay. So it's 100-to-1 ratio. You know, you're getting 0.001 of what people are actually spending, and you have to understand that. Okay. So let's move on here. So that's SoundCloud. Don't rely on one medium. That's the lesson here. So now let's move over to the article by redcode.net. It's talking about, can web music survive? And this is not talking about the servers going down. This is talking more about the idea of digital media and how companies are doing in general. So we're talking about Apple, we're talking about Pandora, all the big guys. And you know, the main point of this article is that iTunes had a huge influence over the music industry. We went from selling albums and having rarity to items and having very high valued things and packages to all of a sudden selling one digital format of one thing at a time. You know, it's kind of like, I made this metaphor before, you know, it's kind of like you go to McDonald's and buy a single fry. You know, you might not buy the single fry, but you'll definitely buy the package of fries. Okay, so what we've done is diluted ourselves, and this is the fault of the record labels, the fault of the artists, the fault of every business person involved to not understand value proposition. You know, if the value's not high enough, we're not going to spend our money on it. So if you're seeing sales go down, it's because the value's not there. And it's not that the song's not good. It's that as a person buying the song, maybe you want a little more than the song. You know, and I've made this example before. It's like you'll go to a concert and spend $100, but you won't spend that dollar on the digital song because it's just not enough value for you. You just want value to exceed the price. And that's where the music industry started, you know, falling off. It's because they're not offering enough value. And the business people should know this. And I'm not even sure why they tried to go down that road as far as iTunes. I guess they saw a quick success with iTunes, but they started treating iTunes like it was their main stream of income and not like what it should be, a reach. Should only be used as a reach, a way to, you know, reach more people that you couldn't reach before. Okay? And they gave into that. And when you play, you know, on somebody else's system and platform, you play by their rules. That's just how it is. And iTunes literally changed the way we go about the music industry. It changed the way people perceive music. And since so many record labels gave in, people were saying there's so much music coming out for $1.29. Why don't we just, you know, have all these releases in the week available for $5 per week? And that's where the streaming sites came into play. There was so much music on that one platform. You know, that platform got oversaturated, not the music industry. The platform got oversaturated, okay? So it means 20 records are trying to come out per day on iTunes. It's hard to keep up as a person buying music, to keep buying records every day. You know, it gets tedious. And that's where the desire for streaming came into play. And that was all based on iTunes' success and also the relinquish of power by the record labels. So again, whose fault is it? The record labels. It's everybody involved in producing the content for iTunes. iTunes doesn't exist if none of the artists and none of the record labels put their music on there, period, unless they bought them out. So that is their fault, and now they're paying the price, and now they say that the music industry is going down. It's actually changing the way we perceive value, okay? So instead of physical albums that they stopped selling for whatever reason, I'm not sure why, they went to the digital form. If you look at digital, now we're looking at streaming, we're looking at digital sales, we're looking at, you know, you have to look at more than just selling that one thing. You have to look at concerts. What are concerts doing? What are festivals doing? Because that is where we're making money as well in the music industry. It's not just downloads, okay? So the music industry is moving, and people who weren't ready for that move are now stuck. For example, people who had huge studios with a bunch of hardware and had plans to just have people come in and record, there's still recording going on in the world, but now the majority of recording is accessible by anybody at home who has a studio. They can record at their home and get a decent quality recording. And if they want to take it to the next level, they can go to the bigger studios. So studios became somewhat irrelevant. Now, where's the issue? It's value creation. It's not that they got undercut by, you know, having microphones and DAWs at home. It's that they weren't providing enough value in the process of selling their studio time. You know, whatever those values may be to the person going to the studio. Do you want help? Do you need an engineer? What's the value? Is the service? Do you like the atmosphere? Is it that you need to, you know, have, you know, whatever studios do to make their customers happy? There are tons of different ways to do that. So now we're just looking at value creation, value proposition at this point. So people got lazy, and that's why they fell off. Okay. So you can't be getting lazy. So now moving on to the next article. This one's about a scientist turning every element in the periodic table into music to help learn the differences between the elements. So it just shows how music goes beyond just selling artist to artist. I say this so many times. There's so many outlets for music, you know, and just only thinking about selling to an artist to get on a beat is thinking in the box. Music, you turn on a movie, you hear music. If you watch the movie Pulp Fiction, the first like 20 minutes is all music. If you go watch any YouTube video, it has music. If you watch commercials, it has a song tied to it. You know, any car commercial has a song tied to it because they know that music is the way to kind of penetrate the brain and insert a message and help people remember what you're trying to sell. So music is selling stuff. It is the industry. Without music, commercials would be super boring. You know, movies would be very boring and not hype. So music is the underlying factor here. And there are other applications of sounds and music that you can get into. You don't have to always do artist-to-artist stuff. You know, there's high-level research labs that, you know, in medical field positions that require having a very sharp understanding of audio. For example, understanding the audio waveforms in a heartbeat and understanding what that means to that heart. Is there a murmur? Is there, you know, palpation? Or whatever the terms are. So those are the things that you can get into in sound. It doesn't have to be artist to artist all the time. So that was the point of that article. Now let's talk about Tidal. Tidal's the new kind of thing here, talking about it versus Apple Music and all the streaming sites. Again, it's not even about the streaming sites. We need to look at the bigger picture here. You know, we're looking at platforms, okay? Platforms where people distribute things, where they have range to send out materials to people, okay? Where they get to build their own relationships with people. So Tidal is more about platform control. It's not even about streaming. Is it doing well streaming? What are the sales streaming? It's about having control over the relationship between you and your client. You know, Apple kind of was the monopoly for a long time because that's just how it was, okay? They made it popular and everybody gave into their plans. And what artists did was they relinquished, or they, use a different word, they sacrificed the connection between them and the person buying their music. So they had no connection. The only person receiving emails or letters was from Apple to the client. It had nothing to do from Kanye, nothing from Jay-Z. You didn't get a letter from Jay-Z or Kanye. You got it from Apple. And Apple controlled the relationship. And all these new streaming sites are all about just controlling, you know, the relationship between the creator and the consumer or the customer. So that's what's really going on. It's not even about, is it streaming? Is it doing blah, 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 whatever, who's on the platform, etc. You know, I went on Tidal. I heard some music that I probably would have never heard if it wasn't curated. So that's another value of the streaming sites like Tidal. It's curated. So that means people sorted through it. It's not just random people posting to Tidal. Okay, so that is the point of this article. Again, is about platform control. Maintaining control over the relationship between you and your client so that you can talk directly to your client and help them and make better products for them. Okay, so let's move on to the fifth article here. A lot about streaming in the news because that's all there is to talk about, really. Because this is like the new face of the music industry. So here, it kind of ties back to an old article we covered. This one says, how streaming music services favor the top 1% of megastars like Justin Bieber, The Weeknd, Drake, and Taylor Swift. So of course, people are going to whine about people gaining more favor over a platform. It's like, you know, the real issue is, why do you think you have to be on this platform? Okay, when you get on different platforms, you play by their rules. They have the control. So that means they can promote whoever they want to promote. They don't have to make it even and, you know, make it based on sales. They can promote Taylor Swift if she's doing a bad week. They can promote her and she could do better. You know, it's their control. They control it. So again, it has nothing to do with streaming and what's, you know, the service. It's more about understanding that they control the rules. And when you get on their platforms and their distribution, their reach, you have to play by their rules, period. They control it. Okay, so all the stats and all the whatever, we already went over the evolution of the music industry. Just make sure you are understanding that when you're getting on new platforms, it's all about reach. It's not about building your business in that business unless they're really trying to help you build your business. Okay, so you're using these like extra arms to pull everybody back to your main website or your main business. And lastly, from Forbes, okay, where they talk about is money. This music festival has now brought over $1 billion to Las Vegas. So I'd mentioned this before. I said music is more than just artist to artist. And I said before that music drives industry. Music drives advertisement. It drives film. It drives music itself. It drives literally in your car. There's so much application to music, okay? We teach with music. There are so many avenues where music is valuable, and music makes money, literally. So until you understand that your music will make somebody else money, you're not going to value your music properly. Your music not only as a producer, for example, if you're making music as a producer, not only is your beat making the artist money for whatever their tour is or shows, those artist songs are then making bigger companies money. Okay, like T.I., he'll sell his song to a movie. Okay, that movie is now making millions and millions of dollars. And T.I., of course, gets a cut, or whoever's on the film. I'm just saying T.I. So it just shows that even if you're thinking about it as producer to artist, yeah, the artist will make more money off the beat, hopefully. That's the whole point in investing in your music. But also, as a team, you and the artist are making somebody else money, you know, making a bigger company money. So that's how you have to think of it, not just the artist to artist exchange. You have to think of it from artist to company exchange, okay? Because music is literally making money in multiple industries. And you can go through today. The takeaway lesson today is listen today. Go out in the world and just listen to how much music you hear and where you hear it. You're going to hear it in the store. You're going to hear it in the car. You're going to hear it at the gym. You're going to hear it, you know, somebody singing. You're going to hear birds tweedleeding, you know, tweeting, whatever the word is, chirping. You're going to hear, you know, music from afar at somebody's party. So just pay attention to how much music is embedded in our culture and how it drives everything, literally. Okay, that's the takeaway for this podcast here at BusyWorksBeats.com. Just a quick new podcast on the producer news, keeping you updated and ahead of the curve. Thanks for watching today. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.